This is KPFT Houston, 90.1 FM.
You're listening to radio station KPFT in Houston. My name is Ray Hill. I'm the host of Execution Watch. We will proceed with the execution of Lester Bauer. In the process of getting ready for tonight's show, I previously interviewed Lester Bauer. That interview will be played later in the show. Right now, we need to find out what's going on in Huntsville, and I believe we have Pat. Pat, are you there?
Yes, I'm watching the family walk in right now. A large contingent of the press had already walked in, and now the family's walking in.
Large contingent, more than usual?
Yeah, it seemed like it. Of course, Michael was there, and then maybe six more.
All right. That's.
You know, the more publicity the state of Texas gets, the more press is here.
Well, that's a good thing, because I think we need to pay attention to these things. Of course, Execution Watch is going to be here whether the case gets publicity or not. But Lester's been there a long time.
He's been there over 30 years. Yes, he's 67 years old.
And looking at a picture that you posted this morning, he was a much younger man when he went in.
Yes. Yes, he was. The church bells have already rang. You know, we think that we successfully got the cops to stop revving the motorcycles, but now they've started ringing church bells.
Okay. But I don't know whether ringing church bells are a good, bad thing. I seem like I remember a novel by the name of For Whom the Bells Toll, and that might bring up a different reflection on that.
But I would much rather hear the church bells. The cops were revving the motorcycles, and they timed it in such a way that it was during the last statement. But okay. Now they're no longer.
Well, so the situation is whenever we get a report from Pat in Huntsville that the witnesses have crossed the road, check me on this, Pat. If I get anything wrong, correct me. That means that at this point, Lester is on a gurney. He's strapped down. There are needles in his arm. The witnesses come in. They pull back the curtain, and the procedure begins.
Yes, it takes the witnesses about 4 minutes to walk from the front door down to the execution chamber. They search them again before taking them in. And then when they get in, we know that that Lester's witnesses are not afforded any chairs to sit in. The other witnesses are. So they will be standing in the small room. And as soon as they get locked in, that room, the curtains will open.
And the next we will hear from you is when the procedure is over.
Yes, we will.
Okay, Pat, sorry about this duty. Sorry to lose Lester. We'll talk to you later.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir. David. I don't have anybody. Okay, we have David Atwood somewhere at a demonstration here in Houston. He's going to report in when we get that contact made. Jim, this has been going on for a while.
Been going on like 31 years, and what's interesting, the lawyers representing him on appeal have been doing it for 26 years pro bono, and that should say a lot for the legal profession.
It does say a lot for legal profession. They're not even in this state.
Well, the ones currently are doing it are not in this state, but there were 26 years of people here in Texas, the lawyers here have done it, and they've done it all on their own.
So with all that lawyering going, is that why the delay? Why?
No, the delay was because on the basis of several post-conviction writs and DNA testing. It was all a bunch of post-conviction writs and DNA testing that delayed everything. Plus, it took the Court of Criminal Appeals 5 years to hand down an opinion on direct appeal.
Direct appeal took 5 years for to get an opinion?
Yep.
There's no time limit on that. There's no way to expedite that. Once you file your briefs and they have whatever hearings they're going to have, then they can take their own merry time.
Lawyers have time limits. Judges don't.
Okay. And so, because in my conversation with Lester, he had had previous dates.
Had seven. This is eighth. It'd be the eighth one. He had seven prior to this one.
And some of them, it was at the last minute it got.
Exactly.
But this one, I went through. The interview with him was an experience, but the listeners are going to get that. Is there anything unusual about that? Now, how many victims were in this case?
Four. Let me say, this is one of the few cases in Texas where killing a man for lying. Because I think if you look at this evidence objectively, I don't think there's any way in the world you could convict him for capital murder. Let me explain what happened. A man by the name of Tate owned a ranch outside of Sherman, Texas, just north of Dallas. He had an ultralight airplane, was an ultralight enthusiast, got a hold of a deputy sheriff friend of his and helped him sell it. They put an ad in the paper. And what happened, that supposedly someone had gone out to see the airplane, and one of the wives, and the man didn't show up at home, went to the hangar and checked it, and all four men had been shot to death, and the ultralight was missing. What happened at that point, they could then trace a series of phone calls that Lester had made to, Bauer had made to the man that advertised the plane for sale, and they went and questioned him. And that's when he became the prime suspect. And I think two things happened in this case. Number one, I think the police focused on him and ignored all evidence to the contrary and only looked at that evidence that looked incriminating him. For example, here's what happened. All four men were shot in the head. All four shots were contact wounds, meaning the gun was up against somebody's head. Everybody had contact wounds to the head. There is no way
one person could have done that.
Because this has all the classic symptoms, you know anything about law, of assassination. Because we have what we call a double tap. When you get a paid killer, that's one of the trademarks, especially the Texas Dixie Mafia, is it's called a double tap. It's two shots to the back of the head. There's no way in the world that one man could get four grown people
to stand still in line
and get shot in the head. There's no way that could possibly have done. Number two, they used a .22 rifle, There were 22 bullets used, and they said it came from an AR-15 or from a Ruger pistol. Ruger pistols and .22 are just absolutely the pistols that are used for all assassins, and the reason being, it's real hard to trace ballistics on a .22 bullet, and they're real good for using silencers. Whichever used the gun had a silencer on both on the weapons. Another thing.
Well, doesn't that show up in the ballistic silencer?
No, it shows up in the autopsy, not in the ballistics.
Oh, in an autopsy.
Because that shows that they never found the weapon, so there'd be no way to tie the bullets to the weapon.
Okay.
So what happens, the reason it shows up, when you have a contact wound, what happens, you have a clean bullet entry, but a circle around it because the blowback sucks up the skin.
Okay.
So you have a little halo around the bullet wound.
Sure.
And you don't have any powder burnings except inside the wound itself. That's why you know it's a contact wound. And then you as a silencer because of the configuration of the formation outside the bullet.
The halo.
Exactly. And so what happened, the way they convicted him, to what they did, and this is another reason I say it's stupid. No one person could have done this by himself. Number two, there were 11 casings found. There have been 11 shots fired. A Ruger only does not hold 11 bullets. So it had to be more than one shooter, or else he had to reload. Now he's going to stop in the middle of killing people and reload.
While they're lined up there.
Right. Plus, there's no sign of a struggle. Plus, nothing was taken. If he stole the ultralight, nothing was stolen from the people. No jewelry, no wallets, no anything. The only thing missing was the ultralight plane.
Well, let me clear something out. An ultralight plane looks kind of like a mosquito.
Yeah, like the table.
Yeah.
A little bit smaller than Mark Mosquito.
Yeah, if you're going to fly an ultralight, you're out in the weather. Right. Yeah, I mean, you're sitting in a lawn chair.
You're sitting in a lawn chair with a motor from a motorcycle, a scooter behind.
Sure.
Wow.
And so it's and you can only fly them, 200 yards, and you got to refuel?
Yeah. But there are lawnmower motors, most of them.
Yeah. So, and this is justification for the cops to think Lester Bauer killed poor people?
No. The problem is he lied too much. Here's what happened. Number one, I think the guy's being executed for being a liar. Another thing I wanted to point out, well, I will go through this scenario, What happened, they traced him down through phone calls he made to the man that put the ad in the paper to sell the ultralight. That's okay. How they traced him down. At that point, he admitted that he claimed that he bought the ultralight airplane from the individuals. He went over there, bought it. They helped him disassemble it. And he claimed that he paid for $4,500. He claimed he paid $3,000 down and gave him an IOU on the back of a business card for the $1,500. Of course, when they found the bodies, no money was found and no IOU was found. That's a serious problem.
Oh, that's a serious.
Real serious problem. Second thing that got him in trouble, he goes over to take a lie detector test, and for some reason no one ever has explained that the FBI, along with the Texas Rangers, were investigating this case. And he refused to take the lie detector test. And he spent a lot of time talking about how much he loved ultralight airplanes. And so that immediately made them suspect that he was obsessed with ultralights and killed these four people for an airplane that's worth $4,000 when he had no criminal record, no history of violence, no history of having any anger. What else hurt him a great deal was he was a gun collector and had a license to carry weapons. Had a license to make silencers on guns. What happened after they interviewed him, at that point, then they decided to go by his house and just talk to him again after the interview. Two FBI agents and a Texas Ranger go by his house. They walk up to his house, and as they're walking up to the house, they look in the garage windows, and they see parts of an ultralight inside of his garage. So at that point, they talk to Lester Bauer. And at that point, since they saw what they thought was some of the ultralight inside the garage, they then got a search warrant and searched the house. When they searched the house, they found, obviously, the ultralight had been missing from the hangar. It was in the garage and just disassembled. Some of the decals had been scraped off. They found all of that. And here's what is real strange. If Lester Bauer had done the killing and he knew he was a suspect, do you think he'd put the parts that came from the murder inside of a garage in plain view so the police could see it? That makes no sense.
It doesn't.
None makes a lick of sense.
Well, the other thing that doesn't make sense is the simultaneous involvement of state and federal officials.
Yeah, that's kind of a moot point. FBI is just
you think
going,
so?
Nah. FBI's, in fact, the Texas Ranger ran everything. And what was funny, Mike and I was talking about this, when they go out to the house to talk to him, the Ranger sent the FBI guys up to peek in the garage before he didn't go to the front door. And no one ever explained how the FBI got involved. It was never involved in federal court. Maybe they had nothing better to do that day. I don't know. Or they wanted to get their picture on television because it's a sensational murder.
Mercy, I think we're ready for Dave Atwood if we can get a flashing light. Dave?
I'm here.
You're there.
We are at the corner of Main Street and Bins across from the museums.
Okay. And that's a good bit of traffic there at this time of day.
Well, it's just a mob of traffic. I mean, people coming every which way. And so great, great visibility for our signs and our banner. And we've got a good group of people out here. We've got 10 people now.
Oh.
We've got a lot of new faces, actually.
Lester has a lot of friends. He's been there a long time.
What? Excuse me?
Lester has a lot of friends. He's been there a long time.
Oh, my God. I mean, every execution is obscene, but this is very obscene considering how long he's been on death row and considering all the factors in his case. I mean, it's just... I thought that this one would be called off by the Supreme Court or somebody. I really did.
Well, it luck just run out on Lester.
Yep.
We've got an interview with him.
30 years in that those conditions. You know, I think the last thing I read from him was that he said, let it go, let it happen. And, you know, it's such a horrible existence that he didn't want to live like that anymore.
Well, the audience is going to hear from Lester himself because I have an interview in this case. You can pick it up off the archive.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Ray.
Jim, excuse me. David, how do people get in touch with your organization?
They go to the website, which is TCAEP.org. That's the Texas Coalition to Abolish the Death Penalty. At TCAEP.org. And that'll tell about things that are going on around the state, in different places, plus, you know, what's going on in Houston.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, too.
That was Dave Atwood. He's here in Houston with a bunch of vigilants opposing the death penalty in this case. Jim, my impression of, just a statement that he used to say, that virtually every wrongful conviction that's ever happened began when one cop turns to another and says, I got a hunch about this case. And they stop trying to investigate the case and they start proving up that hunch.
Well, they focus in somebody, and then they ignore everything to the contrary. For example, I'll repeat again why I think this was a hired killing. Number one, 22s were used. 22s are the gun of choice because it's hard to trace the ballistics on them. Usually everybody who's a paid killer uses a 22. The gun of choice is a Ruger bull barrel. And they do the double tap. It had the earmarks of a double tap. No one in the world, there would have been a struggle if there, these were four adult men he killed in a row with shots to the back of the head.
It's not likely that one person could have done that.
There's no way one person could have done that. And it's impossible.
Well,
and the next thing, he would have hidden the evidence that he found, when he would certainly would have gotten rid of all the evidence that led him to the murder once he knew he was a suspect. He would never have left those ultralight parts in his garage had he done the killing.
Well, if this case is not about stealing an ultralight, an individual stealing an ultralight, is there any hint in the evidence what it might be about?
Well, what happened, there was a lot of rumors that came up in the RIP part. Supposedly, a man by the name Tate was the one that owned the ultralight. He was from Sherman. And there were a lot of rumors going around that he was involved in a cocaine deal and that this was a hit because of something going bad on the cocaine deal and not being paid. But it has all the earmarks of a paid killing. That part you can't deny because the physical evidence indicates that. And so that was a big rumor going around. That's what they criticized the lawyer for. Plus, Tate did some kind of, and also he was a gun collector, and they found evidence that he had bought a silencer. At one time, he had bought a Ruger. And they had some stuff. He had some books on killing people and books on knives, but all these gun collectors have that sort of stuff. Made a big issue out of the fact they found an Allen wrench that you used to put a silencer on. My God, you could come to my house and find an Allen wrench that would meet that. That's one of those things. We're making up mind this guy's guilty, and anything we can dig up, we're going to throw at him.
Yeah.
But he did some stupid stuff, and Sue's, I think, is going to discuss some of the things that he came up with. And I think this guy's being convicted for being a liar. He did not tell the truth. Because here's his problem, Ray.
Yeah.
Assuming that he, here's what his story was. He bought the ultralight, and they helped him load it up, and he took it home. If I had just bought an ultralight and I pick up the paper the next day and see the people I bought from were killed, I would call the police. My God, I was over there that day. I would have told them about it. He didn't do that. And Susan's going to talk a lot about some of the things that he did that hurt him and some of the things he did that made him look guilty.
Okay, Susan, why don't we've got an 18-minute interview with Lester. Why don't I play that and then you pick up after the interview?
Okay.
All right. Well, Dewey, have you got that queued up?
And that very well. Sentence.
I'm not sure. Are there?
Okay.
I understand what that means.
You're right. You're gonna slap me around a little bit. He's got another camera to set up.
Yeah, I'm not exactly sure what I'm.
You got to set up a camera on me.
What I'm with that? I've got anything, you know, to say that this was going to take 20 minutes, but I mean, it is.
Yeah, but the actual interview itself, and I don't edit it. And if you say something that your lawyer might think would affect your case, they ain't getting this interview out of me. I'll go to jail first. And you know goddamn well that's the way that's going to work.
After 26 years, my lawyers know me pretty well.
Yeah.
I know what they want me to do and what they want me not to do. I have been helping Noe's lawyers. I can't tell you Noe's last name. Martinez, I think. They're working on Atkins' claim, and I've worked with Noy for a long time, typed his letters, and almost the same thing, holding hands, just like we did with Penry. And so it's she's been in contact with
Penry bought everybody a lot of time, actually. Penry, they went three times on Penry, and they said, no.
Well,
so Penry bought some time there operationally.
Yes.
Now, see, I don't live on the road. I don't know what it's like to live with Penry.
I suppose it's like living with any other retarded person. There are degrees of retardation.
Sure.
And so there are days.
Why don't we hold this? And if you want to put this in an interview, you don't have
okay.
to. Okay. Let me see. Okay. Ready? Lester Bauer.
It's good to meet you.
I feel like we're friends. We've known of each other for so long.
Well, we are friends.
Are you the only one with a three-digit number? Everybody else has got them 999s.
It's funny when you go down to get a haircut or something like that, they're always going to want your number so that they can log you in. And, of course, I normally just give them the last three digits because that's all anyone
ever... That's what's on the record.
Yeah, I mean, that's all we ever needed. If you gave them a 764, anyone that was anybody knew that that was a triple O because we haven't gotten to 999-764. But, I mean, you've got to re-educate everybody here to figure this out.
Yeah, and we run into that at the front gate.
Yeah.
Is that 999? No, it's Lester's number.
And I'll often say, you did put 000 instead of 999, and there's this silence, and then you can see him down there correcting it because they just assume that that's just the way that it is. But there are still some of us old people sitting around here.
31 years.
And let's remember, I'm only 14th on the seniority list. There are 13 more.
People that were here longer.
Oh, that have been here longer.
Oh, my God.
So it's...
Lester, it appears to me that you're amazingly sane for that.
Hey. Well, I hope so. See, having never met me before, you have no idea what I was like 31...
I do first impressions very well.
Now, but my wife, and I use her as a sounding board. I often say, you know, I think it's Alzheimer's, because I forget things, and she'll sit over there and say, nah, it's not Alzheimer's. You know, you're all right. But I don't, as a person, I'm pretty much the same person I was when I came in here 31 years ago. Now, I'm a little smarter in certain things, just like you're a little smarter in certain things, too, once you've come to prison and you a little bit of experience. And I came here and I was fortunate that one of the persons that I ran into was Jim Vanderbilt.
Okay.
And Jim Vanderbilt said, get into the law books. He says, because at that time, everybody was having a tremendous amount of problems getting lawyers.
Yeah.
I happened to luck out. And so Jim was one of those that always said, always have plan B, and you may be your own plan B. So study the law. So I studied the law and became a paralegal.
Okay.
Got a paralegal for whatever that's worth. And then I ended up helping other people. People would come up with briefs. You know, what do you think about this? And I was one of those people, I didn't sugarcoat things. I read it and I told them, I don't like it. This isn't going to work. Whatever it might be, if the court was working on something, and it's oftentimes the same thing that we did with the Inside Man program.
Mm-hmm.
If there was something the men needed to know about, some case, if for nothing else, just write your lawyer, tell them about this case, and say, look at it. Just this week, I received a letter by various means from. An inmate named Marino came off the row. And I remember when the Supreme Court was deciding the Smith case, and Ward Larkin happened to send me a copy of the oral arguments.
Mm-hmm.
And I looked at it, and I read it, and it was the way the justices were asking the questions. And then they wanted to know, well, how many is this going to affect? You know, and how many people. They had this whole thing figured out. And I went around to a lot of these people that I knew that were going to be affected by the Leroy Smith decision, and I said, you need to attach to it. You need to get a hold of your attorneys. And these were some really good attorneys, Rob Owens.
Yeah.
And people would look at it, and even Marino's attorney said, no, you know, that's, they ain't going to work. And Marino was the type of person that would just sit there and just badger you and badger you. And he said, in the letter, he said, the more I talked to him, the more notes he started to take. He said, once I had him writing notes, that I knew I had him. And he says, by the time the end of the visit, man, he was out of here. He was ready to go. And that was the relief that Marino got. Where on the reverse side, you get someone like Nichols Bay, who he was working in the office with me when I was clerk at the garment factory. Mm-hmm. And so I told Nichols Bay, you know, this is the situation. And he come back and his attorney said, it's old stuff. It isn't going to work. It's been around and, you know, and this type of thing. And I says, yeah, well, the unconstitutionality of the death penalty, Texas death penalty, has been around the horn I don't know how many times, but you got to continue to raise it because at some point it's going to be found unconstitutional, if for nothing else by its application itself. The wording may be constitutional, but the application is not.
You know, we're right on the cusp of that decision.
And I know that. And I tell people, and they're tired.
One justice of the Supreme Court.
They're tired of hearing me say this. We don't have a court up there that is really enough to help us, but they're really trying to do their best not to hurt us.
Well, that's an awful lot of competence on your part, considering your ass is on the line right now.
Oh, 31 years and 6 execution dates. You know, I've been around the horn. I've been here before. I try not to let this bother me. I know other people.
I could take the evidence of the earlier part of this conversation and say, here's Lester Bauer now. He was instrumental in getting the garment factor on death row and became the bookkeeper of that operation. That's a jailhouse politician gig.
Well, I mean, I guess you could kind of say I was lead ho.
Yeah.
Now, I really tried.
He says ho.
Yeah.
He means lead row, which is a little different.
But I try not to do that. I mean, it's.
The language, I'm trying to match my audience.
Yeah. And I was fortunate to get the job in the office more from my education than anything else, you know.
Now, when you say you came down here, you don't mean here. You mean you came to death row in Ellis.
In Ellis.
Which was a different living environment completely.
Absolutely.
And it remained that until the Garuli escape attempt.
That's right.
And then they moved over here.
That's right, 2000.
How do you contrast living circumstances there with here?
You know, it's funny. We knew we were moving for a while. Mm-hmm. And I could remember those people saying, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go. You know, it's going to be great over there. You know, the old hands kind of sat around here and said, I'm not so sure about that. It's really funny. When they built the Terrell unit, then the Terrell unit. Mm-hmm. We still had inmate contractors, inmates working on the building, mm-hmm. and they would write letters, you could still do that, and they said, you know, the blueprints say this is death row. They built 12 buildings over here mm-hmm. for death row. He says, this is what they're gonna do. But then they ran into all that gang problems and they found out they had people a whole lot worse than death row,
sure.
and so they filled it full of all the gang
sure,
people.
Yeah, sure.
And so it's the difference. I think the one difference, the thing I miss the most, and that is the camaraderie, the being able to go out on the yard and sit there and walk and talk.
You could do that easily at Ellis.
Yes.
And it's not as easily done here.
Well, it's impossible. You can go outside and you can talk to one person. You can talk to someone in the day room. All 14 cells in the pod look out on the day room. But like my hearing is gone, and so you literally have to be fairly close to me to be able to for me to be.
You're not permitted to like roam the upper levels and things of that nature.
So I mean, if someone has a legal question from another section or something like that, you've got to really get with the officers or something like that, and work it out, and get the two of you put out at the same time.
At one point in my old prison, Joe, we had the inside man report. And that was generated right here, right where the row was then.
How did that work? And of course, the total conception was Billy Hughes's idea.
Yeah.
Then Billy got with you, and
he said, "I want to."
And said, "Okay, so we're going to do this program," and we were fortunate we had a reporter for the Houston Chronicle. And he would come up and he would put a tape recorder and a little directional microphone right here, and then he'd wait for us and he'd start it, and then he'd go do his own interviews, and then we would sit there and do our little 5-12 minutes, whatever.
And I would get that as a package before the show on Friday.
And then what he'd do on his way back to Houston, he'd just come by and drop the thing off. And as far as I know, it was the only uncensored broadcast from death row anywhere in the country.
And there was no room in there for censorship.
No one.
Because once the tape got in my hand, it was going to go just like this is going to go, without editing, without censors.
Yeah, and that's the way that it was. And we knew that they were listening to it, not the inmates, but we knew that TDC was listening to it, because ever so often they'd make a comment. If you remember, we called a spade a spade. Oh. I mean, if an officer was doing something, we spit out his name, yeah, and heard about it. And so, you know, then Billy got a reversal, and he went back. I was Billy's Ed McMahon.
Yeah.
I was the second man there to kind of keep it going. Yeah. And then when Billy went back, he turned the show over to me, and I brought James Beathard in, mm-hmm, Bubba, brought him in as my Ed McMahon, and then we did that.
What did that feel like to you?
Well, the way I looked at it is it just gave me an opportunity to potentially talk to more of the row than I normally could.
So you're talking to the fellas that are around you.
Actually, I'm talking to the people that are actually that I can't get in touch with, that I can't get to. The people, whether I'm on H-17 or G-15, I can talk to them.
Yeah.
But I tried to spend as little time down on J-Wing as I could, and so those were the people I was trying to talk to, the places that I couldn't, neither Billy nor I could really get to. And that was really our hope, that if there was something that needed to be done, someone needed to be able to tell them, the other inmates, exactly what was going on. And like we said before, reception was kind of iffy back in the...
Oh, no, you had to work for it.
Yeah,
literally, you had to work for it, yeah.
It just...
You know, the first thing I did when I took over KPFT as general manager is I jumped the power from 49% to 100%, got into all kinds of trouble with the FCC, and whenever they showed up and said, why the hell are you doing this? I said, I'm thinking about my convicts.
Yeah. And it's... And back then, we have to remember that when we were talking about less than 30 units.
Yeah.
Now, granted, a whole bunch of those could never hear the show. But those that were in...
We could reach 22 units in the beginning.
Yeah. They couldn't get them all, but get most of them. Now it's even worse, but probably the percentage is the same.
Well, how's the reception with the repeater?
Yes, the repeater.
Works?
That made a world of difference. And not only did it open up the audience for the inmates that could listen to it, but it also opened up for the public that hear it too. Not always did someone want to say, hey, yeah, I listen to the prison program, but sometimes they were just curious enough to turn over to it to see what's going on. You know, what's happening.
Well, I never, on the show, when I did the prison show, I never talked to the free world audience. I talked to the convicts, because that's what it was about and that's who it was for. Now that I do execution runs, I found myself talking to Europe, because that's where my supporters for the end of this madness are located. And I talk to them more over the internet than over the broadcast. But I believe that as screwed up as Texas is, we're getting the word out that there is little shadows of sanity over here somewhere.
You know what I see changing right now? It's when TDC started having trouble with getting their drugs. And then they finally had to come back locally and finally found a compounder who said, okay, I'll make it.
But I didn't work overtime to get that identification out
keep,
there?
Keep my main name on the QT.
Yeah.
And then when the court said, no, you've got to give that up, that is an avenue for those people that want to do something about the death penalty. Every time TDC moves from one of those compounders to another, they need to be out there. They need to be picketing those places, and those compounders don't like that.
No, they don't want that.
And what we need to do is slowly, slowly dry up the supply of chemicals that they are allowed to use. Now the Supreme Court is starting to look at the exact chemicals now. This last thing, they specifically told Oklahoma, do not use the midazolam or whatever.
You ain't gonna do this again.
Now,
they said the same thing to Arizona.
And says, okay, we know that you're experimenting with these things, but there are some of these drugs we do not want you to use. And this is all about the cheap and what they can get on the QT, and they're all trying to work underneath the table. You know, for years they bought drugs illegally under a number, you know, when TDC had the hospital down at the Walls unit, and they just kept that number and kept buying drugs under that authorization, and the authorization wasn't any good.
Your case is largely a circumstantial case.
It is.
Not hardly any tangible evidence there at all. It's all circumstantial. I have blind, I'm just a blind old optimist. I think you're going to beat them.
I wish
there was some way you could beat them and get off the road.
I have six witnesses, and they have come at different times. Six people who told us these are the people who did the crime, people who are in the know. We all got called back to the state district court, and then the judge looked at him and says, you know, I don't think their testimony is credible. You know, they've taken drugs sometime in the past, and you know, some of them are felons and stuff like that. And I think kind of how hypocritical. If these people were testifying for the state against somebody, they'd be the finest witnesses in the world.
Sure.
And so, I've.
What county has your case?
Pardon?
What county?
Comes out of Grayson County.
Grayson County.
Just right up Sherman Denison, right up on the Red River. Go north of Grayson County, and you're in Oklahoma.
Well, execution is serious business, and your ass is on the line.
Yep.
Name's on the list. It's like a week or not.
Yep. It's
You ready for whatever happened? How stoic are you?
If it's going to happen, it's going to happen. I have the finest people working on it. I've done all that I can do. I've brought them along, the lawyers who are not from Texas, but who constantly keep in touch with Texas lawyers to stay abreast of what's happening, Rob Owens and people like that. But if what I know and what they know, if we can't do it, it can't be done. I don't know what else more to say.
Lester, first let me say that I treasure our friendship, even though this is the first time we've ever actually met. But we've known each other through the prison show for years, and to this day I'm still the same old convict I was when I was maintenance bookkeeper on Ramsey. It doesn't change much in my world. I value your friendship and I value your life, and I wish you the very best of luck.
Well, I appreciate that. Like I say, both of us are going to do what we got to do.
Yeah, well, we didn't get this gray hair by accident either.
What gray hair? Every time I go down and see the barber, I say, yeah, just cut the gray hair and leave the brown. And he sits back there, and you can see him hesitate for just a minute and says, well, I don't know what I'm going to do about that.
Thank you, Lester Bauer.
Thank you, Ray Hill.
I should have come over and done this interview a long time ago.
You know, there's a lot of interesting people on the road.
There's a lot of interesting people in prison.
I have often said, in all this walking around I've done and talking cases, and I've heard people tell me a lot of things they wouldn't tell anybody else.
Sure.
And I like
to. You're the old school in the room.
I like, you know, there are offenders, there are inmates, and then there's convicts. And if I got to explain what a convict is to you, you don't need to know, you aren't going to get it. And it's, in all that time, I have met very few truly bad men down here. While at the same time, I've met a lot of men that have truly done bad things.
Oh, yeah.
And we have to separate the two.
Well, none of us are the worst thing we ever did.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lester.
Thank you.
I'm going to move down the way and talk to Rodney for a while.
All right.
Okay.
Okay. Bye.
While we were listening to Lester Bauer and Ray Hill laugh into microphones, the state of Texas killed him. The witnesses have come out across the road. The procedure is over. Lester Bauer is dead after more than 31 years on death row and more than 7 execution dates. He survived. He did not survive this one. Susan was going to tell us a little bit about the wonderful evidence that they used against him.
Well, what came out in the post-conviction? Okay, what came out post-conviction that was raised in the writs that were filed was essentially, there were two real kind of main topics. One was Brady violations on the part of the prosecutor's office, and the other was claims of ineffective assistance of counsel, that his trial counsel did not pursue certain things that might have been viable defenses or called into question the state's case. For one thing, at trial it was presented that the type of ammunition used was a Fiocchi. I'm not sure I'm pronouncing that right, but the state presented evidence that that was a very rare type of ammunition. And apparently, Freedom of Information requests that later were filed seemed to show that it was not a very rare type. It was not nowhere near as rare or as uncommon as the state presented in their case. Also, there were also Freedom of Information requests shed light on that there were claims of people of drug dealing in the area, and that one of the victims was involved in drug trafficking, and that tips came to the police regarding that, and that after the killing at the hangar, there were no additional killings, and that police got tips that the supply of drugs, shall we say, dwindled after the killings due to a supplier being knocked off. There's also was a woman that they called Pearl. Pearl apparently read about the case, the appeal on the case, and Pearl spoke to Bauer's lawyers, and Pearl told them that her boyfriend at the time, back when the killings occurred, had basically admitted to her that he and his friends had done the killings. And apparently there was another woman who was the wife of one of Pearl's boyfriend's friends, and she said the same thing, that her husband at the time had admitted being involved in the killings, and also apparently he had a .22 and he had some Fiocchi ammunition as well. That was not, apparently, though that information was not developed or pursued by Bauer's trial lawyers, and so that's the claim of ineffective assistance of counsel. Additionally, I guess Bauer wanted to take the stand. However, I guess on the advice of counsel, he did not testify in his case. And so these were all things that came out in post-conviction writs.
Mercy.
Now, what the courts held is that none of these things would have changed. There was basically no indication that any one of these things would have changed the outcome of the verdict in the case, that the result would not have been any different.
Let me ask Jim a question. Jim, this is a prosecutor from funny little county up on the Oklahoma border, right?
Right.
If this very same case had happened under the jurisdiction of a prosecutor in Houston or Dallas, the stuff about the multiple simultaneous wings of people lined up and all of that, would that have sent out a different message to those prosecutors than it would have?
I think anybody that had any sense would realize that this does not have the earmarks of him doing the killing. And any prosecutor with any type of – the problem is they focused in on him. And
yeah, but the question is geography. If you're in Grayson County, you don't deal with a lot of mafia killings.
Right.
But if you're in Harris County or Dallas County or Bear County –
you have a lot of hits now, yeah. Because it has all the earmarks of a classic hit of somebody – revenge, because if you're going to rob and steal an ultralight that's only worth $4,000, you're going to take jewelry and wallets too if you're the one that's doing the killing. And see what hurt him a whole bad – really badly, they speculated the gun used was an AR-15 or a Ruger. Number one, he lied that he didn't have a Ruger when records show that he bought a Luger earlier. He lied to them about that, lied about going lied about even meeting and to begin with. And what happened, because he was lying, they thought he had something to hide.
Which probably had something to do with why his lawyer didn't want to put him on the stand.
I would have put him on the stand. From judging from what you heard him say and speak, he's very articulate. Yeah. I would have done it. What I would have done had I been the defense lawyer. Number one, I would have done what Percy Farman did for years, shifted the emphasis. I'd have put on evidence from somebody that's an expert on hits, especially talking about the double taps to the back of the head. I put on evidence that the assassin, the gun of choice, would be a Ruger. I'd put on evidence that the ammunition they got was not that uncommon as they claimed it was. It was an ammunition that's usually used in killing something because it spreads out. And I put on evidence of how many Ruger guns. They speculated it was a Ruger gun. Never found a gun. But I don't think it was a Ruger because, remember, there were 11 shots fired. That means you have to reload. It wouldn't hold 11.
Well, we've already determined that one guy probably didn't do this anyway.
And so I had to put on evidence from that how many Rugers that are available all throughout the United States.
Okay.
And that's what I would have done. And I think the fault lies primarily with the lawyer, not with the prosecutors.
Mike, what you got?
I'm here to talk about the issues that was brought up in the direct appeal concerning the illegal search. What happened in this case is that the key to the case is when the policeman came up to the door of Mr. Bowers to talk to them, they looked into the garage. The argument by the lawyers on appeal is that that's a violation of the Fifth Amendment because they didn't have the right to look into the garage. So we're going to talk about that issue. The way that works in Texas is that when you have a house and you have a sidewalk, it is implied that people, salesmen, tradesmen, newspapermen, police officers, have the right to use that path to come up to the door and knock on the door. As long as they're on that path, they're not violating any law because it's an implied invitation for people to come in. The trouble becomes is looking into the garage. What the courts basically said is that the police officer who's got the right to walk up the sidewalk is not assumed to be blind, that anything that can be seen by him through normal vision is not protected property. What protected property is a property that somebody expects not to be seen. And when you have a garage on the pathwalk without curtains on it, the court is holding that you did not expect privacy when you did not put curtains on the garage that's right on the pathway coming up to the door. Now, all of this could have been solved by something as simple as a no trespass warning. If there was a no trespass sign outside the house, then it goes just the opposite, that there's no implied invitation, that you cannot walk on the sidewalk and knock on the door. The no trespassing sign says you're not invited. But in this case, there was not a no trespass sign.
What about the problem of being able to identify a disassembled mosquito in the garage?
I thought about that same topic because, to me, once you disassemble the plane, there's just a bunch of pipes. How can you look at a pipe and see that it's made of aluminum, the labels were off of it, whether or not pieces of pipe were part of an ultra live was not developed in this case, but I thought the same thing in looking at it. It's one thing to look into a window and see weapons or see drugs or see cash, but when you look into a window and all you see are some pipes, how do you know that these pipes are part of an ultra wide? They never developed that, those facts.
If you had been a lawyer in this case, would you have brought that forward?
I'm still puzzled by, the problem with this case, Jim has already laid out, it doesn't make any sense that one man did it. It makes no sense that one man with no criminal activity would do such a bloody murder.
But have the know-how to do it.
To do something of that nature. And then we have the after-developed facts of people talking about a drug hit, an assassination. You have girlfriends of people who say, my boyfriend did it. I don't know how that can be ignored.
Mike, what was the problem there? Was it their inability to overcome the trial court's finding of facts in the law that allowed them to exclude the subsequent evidence?
I think what happened is what was stated already is that the court, when they heard these witnesses, said they were unbelievable. And as Susan already said, they would have been believable if they were there for the state, but because they were there for Mr. Bowers, they were not considered believable.
Lister said that, actually.
Oh, excuse me.
Yeah, but he said that very clearly. He said if these people had been there to testify the state, these witnesses have been just fine.
See, Ray, we've talked about this numerous times before. The big problem is when those witnesses came forward at a writ hearing. Mm-hmm. A writ hearing is heard in front of the judge who heard the case to begin.
Yeah, just finding facts.
And all the writ judge has to say is, I don't think they're credible, I don't believe them. And if there's some evidence to support that, and it's his opinion, then the appellate courts are bound by that decision. And so here you have an elected judge when four members of his community have been killed. Mm-hmm. A jury had found them guilty based upon the fact, but primarily that they think a Ruger was used. There was no evidence a Ruger was used or an AR-15. He had ordered a Luger and lied about owning a Ruger at one time. He had equipment. He had bought a silencer. They had invoices showing he had bought a silencer, which is not unusual because he was a licensed gun dealer. And all these guys who are involved in guns have all sorts of crazy equipment they buy and stuff. Sure. He had a book on how to kill people. Well, killing people with a gun is pretty simple. You point it and pull the trigger. You don't need a lesson.
But you don't necessarily
that.
Know how to double tap from reading
double,
the book.
And double tap has absolutely the earmark of a paid
of
killing. Of a hit. Absolutely.
These are professionals.
Absolutely. And they left.
And Lester Bauer wouldn't make a pimple on a professional's butt.
No way. And see, there was no sign of a struggle. There was no struggle inside the garage. Nothing was turned over, and there was no struggle. And you're going to tell me that one guy walks into a garage, two of the men he kills, one's an ex-policeman, other's a current policeman, and we have four people, and he shoots all four of them in the back of the head with contact wounds, and they all just laid there, and there's no fight? That's stupid. Nobody would believe that. But here's the problem. At that writ hearing, when the judge heard those witnesses that testified that Tate, the man who owned the ultralight, was involved in drugs, the judge is the sole finder of the credibility of the witness, and the appellate courts say he saw him testify, we're going to bow to his judgment whether they're believable or not. So he basically, this is why you should never have a writ hearing in front of the judge who heard the trial.
Jack, have you got anything to add to this?
I do, and I'm going to go a little bit off script a little bit here. When I first read this, I saw Julio Fiocchi ammunition, and I thought, wow, this because there are boutique ammunition people out there who specifically will think they have a better mousetrap. They'll come up with specific ammo and so on and so forth. I did a little research on it, and Julio Fiocchi ammunition comes from the Fiocchi Ammunitions ammunition factory in Italy, and it is one of the largest ammunition gun manufacturers in Italy. Specifically, these 22s probably came from a factory based in Missouri. It's a large enough corporation that they actually applied to.
Sure.
and tested their ammunition with NATO so that they could be a contractor for NATO. Okay. This is not a small, you know, small guy in a garage who makes specific ammunition for hitmen or anything like that. This is a really large corporation. There is nothing particularly special about this ammunition, except perhaps it's the favored, you know, favored ammunition for.
Wait a minute! Didn't the state say this was rare stuff?
It is
That's what they said at trial.
It is not rare at all. Yeah. It has a funny name, but it ain't rare.
It's as rare as a Nissan Sentra.
I better be careful what I drive.
You know, this leads into what I...
Can we conclude from all of this that this is one of those things where they didn't have enough tangible evidence to justify the execution of this guy?
What they do in that, they make up for it by showing all the dead bodies. Sure. That's what they do for it. They scare the hell out of you.
The jury.
Yeah, out of the jury.
It's a performance piece.
Exactly.
On the prosecutor's side.
Exactly.
Have you ever run across prosecutors like that? Want to put on a show?
One out of every three, give or take.
Really?
Yeah, sure.
There used to be a saying in the DA's office, they'd laugh about it. Anybody can find a guilty man guilty. Find a guilty man guilty.
No, that
was... Takes real talent to convict an innocent
Chuck
man.
Rosenthal quote.
No, well, that was well before Rosenthal came along. That was flopping around for years.
Takes real talent.
It's a real lawyer to convict an innocent man.
And they brag about that when you...
Absolutely.
And every now and then you'll find some prosecutors who really do take their oath of seeking justice seriously.
Sure.
And those are the
ones... No, they're good people.
They're good people
in every profession.
Truly fantastic.
I would say there are bad people in every profession, but I haven't run across any recently. Let me tell you, we're laughing because they just killed a man that the killing of which any reasonable, objective person would agree there ain't enough here.
Well, see, Ray, in any murder case, the first thing you look at is the physical evidence. And Jack had pointed this out. The physical evidence indicated, thought we just talked about it before, and what happened, if you look at the physical evidence, it does not fit the idea of a man, one single person doing the killing. Only a fool would believe that. It doesn't fit. It fits all the evidence of a paid hit.
You've been listening to Execution Watch. Lester Bowers is dead. My name is Ray Hill. I'm the host of the program. I want to thank Jim Skelton and Susan Ashley, Mike Gillespie and Jack Lee. We miss the presence of Larry Douglas, who is somewhere stranded in Jefferson, Texas, trying to take up something that looks like business. Pat Hartwell, we appreciate your coverage in Austin. You told us they were about to kill him, and you told us that they did kill him. Dave Atwood out here helping a herd of vigilance. I'll let the public know that there are some of us who are opposed to killing. The next execution is scheduled for June the 18th. It is Gregory Russo. We have an interview with Gregory that Mark Pertle is putting together, and we'll videotape that show and that interview. Our producer is Elizabeth Stein. ELIZATEXUSA@gmail.com is how you can find her. Put the puncture in as best you can figure it out. Technical director is Otis McClay, who attached us to the internet. On the board, we have none other than Frank Dewey, the wonderful Dewey from The Prison Show all these years. Our video photographer is Mark Pertle, and he will have this edited and on Houston Media Source very shortly. The music you're hearing in the background is by Victoria Panetti, whose brother lives on death row. This is radio station KPFT Houston. I'm Ray Hill. Good night.
Good show. Good show.
Amazing show. Tough for me.
I can imagine. And Jim, your analysis, I never looked at it like you did, but absolutely you couldn't have done it. There's no way you could have done it.
It is no human way.
Well, we told you what I'm saying.
It's impossible.
We told it. Whatever it was, we told it.
And yet that's not in the 50th of the council.
I mean, it's stretching it to kill someone.
I need everybody's notes.
Over one ultra
Susan Jax is on the internet. So
where's all these all
time? There's two shots in the back of the head.
Okay.
I need to walk up behind a guy, four of them in a row, and shoot him in the back of the head. No way.
Well,
no way.
You're not going to get Monica Gomez to kill four guys.
No.
Okay.
We
got a show coming in. Hurdle we got to break down.
Get out. Okay. Jim, I did all that prep, and then I realized
I don't have the time.
Right. Think of future things. Great. I love that fact that ammunition stuff.
Yeah.
That's great stuff.
Mechanical mosquito.
I find them all. I just figured that was a lot more interesting.
Excellent.
That's stretching it there. Okay, but let's just.